Here we are at Billy's house. Billy is inside getting ready for his first date. We're going to help him along. Billy? Billy? Are you excited about your first date? Good. Good. Always make sure to wash your hands after brushing your teeth. Billy, Billy, don't bother with push-ups. She has to like you for who you are, not what you look like. No, Billy, don't give her flowers. That's so cliche. Here, give her this. Well, better get going. Billy, aren't you forgetting something? No, Billy, the flowers. Good boy. You never know when you might need them. Don't bring her there. She'll think you're trying to impress her by spending a lot of money. Bring her somewhere that will reflect your humility. Ah, a chili cheese dog with extra onions. That's the way to a woman's heart. Tasty, huh? Now, how about a ride in the country to help digest? Ooh, out of gas. Don't panic. Make the best of a bad situation. Yes, let her push. She'll admire your lack of male chauvinism. Billy, things are going pretty well, huh? I think she really likes you. Now, Billy, I want you to go home, get one egg beater and two pieces of... Billy, remember what I told you? Now, Billy, now. Hey there. He's kind of a geek, isn't he? You want to get a cup of coffee? Here, let me put this camera down.
Hair left, you assholes.
Well, you better do it quick, Murphy.
Cut it out,
dog dance.
Come on, this might be funny on Earth, but we're on a scientific mission. Guys?
Wait, I've established radio contact with the life force. It's feeding us a message directly into the computer. What's it say, Chuck? Yeah, what's it say? It says, do the funny things. Guys, I'm not doing the fucking funny thing. Seriously, guys, the fucking funny thing totally hurts. Look, I'll beep like a Jeep. Look. I beep, beep, I'm a Jeep. Look, look. Beep, beep, I'm a Jeep. Beep, beep. Nope, funny face. Oh, God damn it, okay.
Do it.
You guys, my oxygen is down to 1%. 1%? Gosh, you better quit playing around, huh? Yeah. Yeah, we better stop teasing Mr. I want to be the first person to walk on Mars. Huh? Mr. Neil, me first Armstrong. Come on, you guys. We draw straws and I won fair and square. You just had to be the first man to walk on Mars, didn't you, Murphy? No, all three of us were the first man to walk on Mars. I...
Dude, that's awesome!
There goes Mr. Fucking Neil Armstrong.
Ah, you guys don't even fucking care if I die.
Hey, Captain, you better come here. Looks like we got another one.
What? Another one already?
Bearing 249er right downtown, sir.
Is it Godzilla again?
It's too big to be Godzilla. And it isn't flying, so it's not Rodan or Mothra.
What is it?
The computers can't match it at all. I don't think we've ever seen this creature before, sir. God, I hope it can't shoot lasers out of its eyes. I hate when they can do that.
Oh, hey, Tony.
Oh, hey, Bob.
How you doing?
What have you been up to lately?
Oh, not a lot. I've been bowling a lot lately, actually.
Oh, really? I have several bowling balls at home.
Oh.
As a matter of fact, Marge was just telling me that I have too many bowling balls for one man. You know, sometimes I think she's jealous of my bowling balls.
Say, but... Tony, knock, knock.
Huh?
Knock, knock.
Who's there?
A giant beaver about to kill us both!
Shelter! Got confirmation, sir. Looks like it's a giant beaver this time.
A giant beaver? Why can't it pick on some other city?
Well, I'll bet you my last nickel it's one of them Sri Lankan bastards. I've heard they grow to over 70 stories tall.
All right. Listen, I want choppers, I want tanks, I want all the usual stuff.
Well, what about the girl? You know, the pretty girl that the beaver can fall in love with and then go home. God, we can't do it without the pretty girl. We gotta have a pretty girl.
Oh, right. Yeah. Bob, can you find a pretty girl?
Yeah, sure, I can do that.
Go find one.
What the hell was that?
I don't know, but I'm getting the hell out of here.
If you just be patient with
prisoners, we need somebody to go out and try to reason with the beaver.
Sure. I guess I can go out there and try. Wait a minute. How do I reason with a giant beaver?
Excuse me, Mr. Beaver. Mr. Beaver, excuse me. Down here. Down here. I would like to kindly ask you to leave our city? Hello? You're doing a lot of damage and we need you to leave, please. There are plenty of other cities to destroy. We've had our share, thank you. Mr. Beaver? Huh?
Keep hearing this melody in my ear.
Frosty the Snowman, what a jolly happy soul, with a corncob pipe and a button nose and two eyes made out of coal. There must have been some magic in that old stove cat they found, for when they placed it on his head,
dude!
What?
Don't put the magic hat on the snowman.
Why?
Because if you do, he's gonna come to life.
Cool.
No, it's not cool. My sister in Minnesota put a hat on a snowman and it tried to kill her.
Fuck him. Let's do it anyway.
Yeah.
There must have been some magic in that old silk hat they found. But when they placed it on his head...
Now, didn't I?
Well, I'm sorry, Mr. Rocket fucking scientist. What are we supposed to do now?
I don't know what we're supposed to... Wait, I bet he can help us.
Who?
Whoa, now tell me what happened slowly.
Okay, we're just building a snowman, and all of a sudden, he came alive.
I told him, I said, don't put the magic hat on the snowman. And he did it anyway, and then he killed our friend Kenny, and now he's gonna kill everybody.
Did he look kind of like this?
Yeah, kind of like that.
Mm-hmm, exactly. You know, I don't think that was the real Santa Claus.
Oh, no shit, Sherlock. You know, thanks to you, there's not going to be any Christmas, and there's no one left to help us.
Oh, Christ.
Jesus! Jesus. We beseech thee, in this time of need...
Okay, fucking Frosty, he fucking killed
Sue,
my friend.
Sue, this is Jesus.
You don't say fuck in front of Jesus.
Oh, Jesus.
That sucked. I'm sure glad that's over with.
Yeah, but you know, I learned something today.
Yeah, don't put the magic hat on Frosty.
No, I learned about the true spirit of Christmas.
Really?
Yeah, Christmas isn't about Frosty or Santa.
You're right. It's about Jesus.
No, it's not even about Jesus either. Well, then what's it all about? Prisons. You see? Prisons. Hey, man, let's go home. I know where my parents hide my presents.
Cool. Ah.
So he waved goodbye, saying, "Don't you cry, I'll be back again someday."
Let me tell you about American history. Oh, wait, stop, and go. Let me tell you about American history. At first, Columbus found this continent in 1492, and he started killing many Indians. And then pilgrims landed at Plymouth Rock and had a big party with Indians. And then they made 13 colonies on this continent and banned witches. But in England, King George didn't think well about new continent, and he raised taxes like Bush. So Americans pissed off, and Boston Tea Party happened. They threw the tea, threw away the tea in the sea, and she turned like tea. They put the milk in. In 1776, Thomas Jefferson wrote Declaration of Independence. So, Revere alert the people by using one if by land, two if by sea. He did. And after the George Washington crossed a river, remember the Alamo? American wins. And then Americans headed west, the final frontier, to boldly go where no man has gone before, and kill a lot more in India. When Abraham Lincoln became a president and become a penny. And then Civil War happened. No side wins. Here is Gettysburg Address. Fourscore and 7 years ago, our fathers said, "To the people, by the people, for the people, and in of the people, remember the Alamo." Lincoln shot by Booth. 1914, World War I occurred. Over there, over there, send the world, over there. This is a famous song from World War I. After Great Depression, Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor, then occurred World War II. And World War II ended by atomic bomb, and some radiation influenced Japanese brain and made them intelligent. 1950s, they started TV drama named as Leave It to Beaver. This is a great drama. It's great. And then John Fitzgerald Kennedy was assassinated by CIA. And then American made an actor as a president named Ronald Reagan. And after Reagan, Americans made George as a president. And he went to Japan and tried to sell the American car, but he After this failure in Japan, Bush got back and started Japan bashing. He is driving a Japanese car, and wearing Walkman and watching Sony TV. Remember the alarm.
Seeking retribution.
He's come to kill you because you're Jewish, Kyle.
Oh, fuck! I'm sorry, Jesus! Don't kill me!
Nay, fear not. I love all my children.
Whew.
Tomorrow is my birthday, yet all is not right.
Your birthday is on Christmas? That sucks, dude!
I must find a place called the mall.
Well, we could take you to the mall, Jesus. Yeah, it's over this way.
Oh, God damn it! You stepped on my foot, you pig fucker!
Dude! Don't say pig fucker in front of Jesus!
Ah, fuck you.
Here we are, Jesus. South Park Mall. Who are you looking for?
Him. Ho, ho, ho. We meet again, Jesus.
You have blemished the meaning of Christmas for the last time, Kringle.
I bring happiness and love to children all over the world.
Christmas is for celebrating my birth.
Christmas is for giving.
I'm here to put an end to your blasphemy.
This time we finish it. There can be only one.
Dude, this is pretty fucked up right here. Go, Santa! Go, Jesus!
Zhang Quan Do!
Yuk Tuki!
Oh my God! They killed Kenny!
Oh, you son of a bitch! Come on!
Boys, help me put an end to him once and for all.
No, boys. Help me, so that I can put an end to him.
God is watching you, boys. You know who to help.
Stan, remember the choo-choo when you were three?
I died for your sins, boys. Don't forget that.
I don't know what to do, dude. Who should we help?
I say we help Santa Claus.
You're just saying that because he brings you candy.
Hey! I don't need to take that kind of shit from a Jew.
You're such a fat fuck, Cartman, that when you walk down the street, people go, God! Damn it! That is a big fat fuck!
Oh, yeah? Well, listen to
that! I'm not a motherfucker! Don't fuck you! I'm not a motherfucker! Fuck you!
Wait, just a second. Now, we've got to think here. Now, let's see. What would Brian Boitano do?
Yeah, what would Brian Boitano do?
Did someone say my name?
Brian Boitano!
What incredible irony!
Hey, it's Brian Boitano!
What's going on, kids?
Okay, Brian. Who would you help in a fight, Jesus or Santa Claus?
Kids, you shouldn't think of things like that. This is the one time a year in which we all try to get along, no matter what we believe in. This is the season just to be good to each other. Bye.
Go, Uncle
Boy! You fucking pussy!
Hey, Jesus!
You have to understand that Santa is keeping the spirit of your birthday alive by bringing happiness and joy.
Yeah, and Santa, you need to remember that if it weren't for Jesus, this day wouldn't even exist!
You're right, kids. I'm sorry, Jesus.
No. It's me who should be sorry. I've been a right bastard. I'm sorry, Kringle.
Thank you, boys.
Yeah, thank you, boys. Come on, Kringle. I'll buy an orange smoothie.
Ooh.
Phew. That sucked.
Yeah, but you think, today we actually met. We actually spoke to the Brian Boitano.
Yeah, and you know, I think I learned something today. It doesn't matter if you're Christian or Jewish or atheist or Hindu. Christmas still is about one very important thing.
Yeah, ham.
No, not ham, you fat fuck!
Fuck you!
Christmas is about something much more important.
What?
Presents.
Ah.
Don't you see, Kyle?
Yeah.
Presents.
Hey, man. If you're Jewish, you get presents for 8 days.
Wow, really? Count me in.
Yeah, I'll be a Jew, too.
Dreidel, 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 I made you out of clay. And dreidel, 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 then dreidel I will play.
Hollywood, California, home of the magical talking picture. A mecca of entertainment, Hollywood has always been known as a land of romance and a sparkling beacon for a life of glamour. Beneath the clear blue skies of the San Fernando Valley is Universal Studios, a company whose name has always been synonymous with classic talking pictures. In addition to timeless masterpieces like these, Universal is also widely known for its thrilling theme park. Yes, these elements have all combined to make Universal Studios what it is today. But what about tomorrow? If we don't keep in step with the times, things that once were neat and thrilling can become old and stupid.
Whoa, 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 whoa. What is going on here? Ladies and gentlemen, this never happens.
Look out! It's a shark! Here it comes! The shark is coming!
That's right. Old and stupid.
Look out! All you back there is in the back of the tram! Whoa! That is one big, scary shark! Oh, the humanity! Isn't that terrifying?
To keep up with the times, one must constantly modernize. And that's true for our studio, too. But how can we improve the studio? Well, first of all, in order for the studio to prosper in the future, we need to apply modern, futuristic ideas. The first of these ideas is being artist-friendly.
Say, what does that mean, artist-friendly?
To find the answer, let's start where most people get their first impression of our studio, the front gate.
Hello.
Oh, look, here's MCA recording star Tracy Lords. She's thinking of acting in an upcoming film here at Universal.
Your papers, please.
But the attitudes of the guards and the bleak, unattractive surroundings make Miss Lords feel uncomfortable and unwelcome.
I feel uncomfortable and unwelcome.
Of course you do. But what if our gate was more artist-friendly? We'll start with the guards. Those dark uniforms connote oppression and conformity. But new outfits with pastel colors and high, pretty collars seem to say, I'm your friend, not your enemy. How about some inspiring buttons to show our optimism? And what about that security gate? Black and white lines may remind artists of police and fear. But a new gate, with attractive flowers and colorful birds, becomes a lovely decoration, not just a deterrent. Now, with just a few more changes, and some attractive porcelain deer, our gate is now artist-friendly and ready for the future. So how do you feel now, Miss Actress?
I feel welcome and relaxed from a meeting at Universal.
That's splendid. Too bad the part you want will probably go to Demi Moore.
What?
Oh, nothing. Here, have a wine cooler. Compliments of your new studio.
Thanks.
Now, don't open that until you park. Now, what else will make our studio artist-friendly? Well, how about that old black tower? In the past, many meetings have taken place there, but some people find it rather unappealing.
Oh, absolutely. You know, foreboding is the word that best describes it. You know, it's like real severe, you know. I mean, just a name like Black Tower, I never want to go there.
We certainly don't want to breed fear and contempt into our guests. So let's try some different colors. How about the White Tower? Or the Plaid Tower? That's right. Now let's just add a porcelain deer for decoration.
Tell Ron Murray to be a man and say that to my face. An artist-friendly atmosphere should prevail, not only outside, but inside as well. A neat and tidy office, complemented with the proper flowers and appropriate decorative garnishes, will make artists feel at ease, and thus aid in the pitching process.
That's right, Andrew Bergman. But Artist Friendly is also in how we treat each other.
Wait, Mike! Mr. Lobel! You forgot your profit participation check.
Wow, 8 million.
And have some Seagram's wine coolers. On
Ooh,
us!
This...
And here's a little pig for the kids.
Oh, thanks.
Thanks for choosing Universal.
Neat. Thank you.
Thank you, Mike.
There now, Kevin Misha. Doesn't that make you feel a lot better?
Why, yes. Yes, it does.
Yes, we can all do our part to make the studio a more beautiful, artist-friendly place.
Sweeten, enhance, beautify. Sweeten, enhance, beautify. Sweeten, enhance,
Looks like James Cameron's got the idea. Say, Sean Cassidy.
Who, me?
How do you like those complimentary wine coolers?
I'm blitzed on this stuff, right?
Sweeten, enhance, beautify.
Gosh, with all the wonderful improvements going on around here, everyone is going to want to work at Universal.
Yes, and that brings us to our second point. Now that we're artist-friendly, it's time to build our talent roster. You see, sometimes making things more beautiful doesn't make them better. They can still be old and stupid. So we've spent a lot of money and brought in some of the best artists the world has to offer. Like stunning actress Demi Moore.
Yes, it's true. I did just join the Universal family. Casey, Hal, Ron, they're like fathers to me. Grandfathers, even. Besides, being with the Universal family makes me feel secure, so I have more free time to do the things I love, like baking ham. Hon, ham's on!
We've also acquired director John Singleton.
And action!
Here's John on the set of his new movie, Shut Your Honky-Ass Mouth, Cracker Boy.
And cut! I am happy to be part of the new MCA Universal family, where I plan to make a lot of money.
Can I get my wine cooler now?
Certainly.
Seagram's, bold and wine cooler, Seagram's.
Yes, and we've also just bought the Zucker Brothers.
We're really happy with the way we've been treated so far at Universal.
Yeah, they're so much different from all the other studios we've been at.
Yes, but we don't want you thinking about other studios. In fact, we want you to forget there even are other studios. Forget. Forget.
Forget.
Forget.
Forget.
Forget.
Forget.
Good. Good.
Forget.
That's right. Forget.
Forget.
But our new acquisitions are not only in the film world, we're also going multimedia.
Say, what does that mean, multimedia?
Well, for the answer to that question, let's go to New York City. Universal is steadily making its presence known in the Big Apple. Here at Universal Records, new bands and recording artists are signed every day. Here's the drummer from the hot new band Goldfinger. Say, young whippersnapper, how would you like to be a part of the Universal MCA Corporation?
Fuck you! Corporation bullshit, corporate whore, fuck.
Ooh, that teen angst sells a lot of records for Universal. Give that man a wine cooler.
This is the shit! Fuck you!
We also have MCA records with rap stars like Heavy D.
Golly, it sure is nifty to be a part of the Universal family. I mean, jeepers, everybody here is just swell. Golly willikers, how could I ever go anywhere else? I mean this.
And now it's on to Nashville, where we've signed some of country's hottest performers, like Marty Stewart.
I don't know how things could be any better here at Universal. They take such good care of us artists. Well, like for instance, when my album went gold, I got this beautiful deer in the mail.
But we don't stop there. Multimedia includes books, too. That's why Universal owns Putnam Berkeley, with best-selling authors like Robin Cook. Say, Robin, how does it feel to be with Universal?
I love it. It's probably the best thing that's happened to me. Here, have you seen my newest book? Pre-written in screenplay format. Saves a lot of time. Now my book can go directly to the movies, which is a real plus, because those executives who can't read can go see the cute little talking picture.
Yes, Universal is busy making acquisitions all over the country in order to become a worldwide multimedia conglomerate of entertainment. Just ask Sylvester Stallone.
Universal sure is buying a lot of stuff.
Say, isn't that producer Barry Kemp?
Say, what about the future? We can't just keep relying on existing talent. We have to be open to new talent.
That's right, Barry Kemp. And ironically, that brings us to our final point. The last key to a modern studio is having an open-door policy.
Say, what does that mean, open-door policy?
It means anyone can share their ideas. This keeps our studio from becoming old and stupid. But where do we find new talent? You might be surprised at the answer. This is Pepe. Pepe has a great idea for a blockbuster hit movie involving two women and a lost dwarf.
I'm just a janitor. Nobody wants to hear my ideas.
Don't worry, Pepe. You work for Universal Studios, and here they welcome all ideas.
And the two women and the dwarf live happily ever after. How do you like my idea, Mr. Executive?
Write it all out, and I'm going to submit it to my development people right away, okay?
Wow, really? Thank you.
Oh, and Pepe, would you empty the trash for me, please? That's a good janitor, thank you.
Sometimes crew members on film shoots are a source for ideas.
I've been in this business for a long time, and I've always lived by one simple philosophy. Be nice to the little people. Good morning, guys. I brought pastries. Ooh. Because down the road of life, you simply never know who your boss is going to be. From the lowliest PA to...
Pardon me, ma'am. Do you have anything else besides jelly?
You'll eat what I give you to eat and be glad to have it. For instance, when I made clam bake with Elvis, there was...
Yes, an open-door policy allows us to find the newest, freshest ideas. Isn't that right, Mr. Stallone?
You know, it's good to be open to new talent, because that way you're more open to new talent and stuff.
So let's review our three modernizing techniques. One, being artist-friendly. Two, building that talent roster. And three, never say no to a sailor.
Say, what does that mean? Never say no to a sailor.
Yes, it's a whole new Universal here. And because of all the great changes being made here, Ron and I have decided to stay. We're both making ourselves completely available and accessible for all the studio-related functions. Ron says things are great and he's fine.
So now we're just one big happy family of movies, books, music, television, and liquor.
People, people who need people.
Yes, from all around the country, artists are starting to call Universal City Studios home. Universal City Studios, UX. And with all of our new changes, no wonder everyone is saying, it sucks for me.
It sucks for me.
And how about you, Alan Hughes?
Hey, it sucks for me, too.
Yes, and it sucks for him, and it sucks for her, and it sucks for all of us.
Gee, I had no idea Universal was making so many changes and stuff.
By constantly changing, updating, and improving, we will never fall into the trap of becoming... It's the dawning of a new day. And with our new regime, we're becoming the most modern studio we can be. Thank you.
Okay, look, you're going to tell them I don't talk that way, right? I mean, this whole thing's been a gag to put on. I put the Rocky thing behind me. It's a character. You're going to work on that, right? You're going to tell them. I can...
Sure, Brainiac. Here, have a wine cooler.
Thank you very much. See, that's a character thing. It's something I work on. Fucking cheap studio.
Thank you. Goodbye.
What would you say are the most important things about you?
My values.
My ability to recognize talent.
Honest with my
with my family and friends.
I'm intelligent, I'm attractive.
My personality is very important.
I have no idea.
Hello, I'm Dennis Prager.
And I'm Larry Elder. You notice that no one said anything about race or ethnicity? Almost everything else, but not that.
That's because deep down we all know that the color of our skin and where our ancestors were born don't tell anyone anything important about us. As you can see, I have very white skin.
And I don't.
I'm Jewish.
I'm not.
I was born in Brooklyn.
South Central Los Angeles.
My grandparents came to the United States from Poland.
I, on the other hand, don't have a lot of Polish ancestry.
You now know our race and ethnicity. Do these things tell you anything important about us? About our values, our abilities, our personalities, our interests, our passions, or most important, our characters?
And does knowing our race and ethnicity tell you anything about the qualities that would make you want to consider either of us as a friend or as an employee?
What if by magic I could suddenly have black skin?
What if by magic I could have white skin?
Or brown skin?
Or yellow skin?
Would that give you a better clue as to who I, Dennis?
Or who I, Larry, really am?
Why then, if race and ethnicity are so unimportant to our character, has so much attention been placed on racial and ethnic diversity?
That's because of the well-intentioned desire to correct the prejudice which we all know exists.
Wow, these are fine credentials, Mrs. Johnston, just fine. I see you graduated from the University of Illinois.
Yes, and as you can also see, also worked for 3 years for Smith Aircraft.
Oh, that's fine, Mrs. Johnston, just fine. I'll think it over. Goodbye.
Well, I know I could do the job, sir.
I'm sure you could, little lady. Goodbye. Oh, Miss McGillicuddy, send in the next applicant, please. Ah, hello, young whippersnapper. Where did you go to college?
I didn't.
I see. Had any experience?
No, but that's fine. Just fine.
Fine, just fine.
Fine.
Any reason you feel qualified for this job?
Well, I'm white, and I'm a male.
Oh, yeah! Son, you just talked yourself into a job.
Well, that's how it often was, folks. Racial and ethnic minorities were often denied promotions or jobs, not because they weren't qualified, but because of their race, gender, or ethnicity.
Now, if you want to solve this problem, you have two choices. One, replace the old racial, ethnic, and gender considerations with new racial, ethnic, and gender considerations, and that way end up with a diverse workplace.
Or two, end all racial, ethnic, and gender considerations and simply hire people of ability and good character, and that way end up with a diverse workplace. You see, many well-intentioned people have opted for the first choice, aiming for diversity by emphasizing race, ethnicity, and gender in hiring. But there's a tremendous problem with this solution.
It's based on the same assumptions as the original problem, namely that people's race, ethnicity, and gender are very important. But they aren't. And that is why there is so much confusion over what diversity really means. For example, would you say this is a diverse group? According to today's understanding of diversity, you would say yes. Now, would you say this is a diverse group? According to today's understanding of diversity, you would say no. They're all one race. Now let's go back to the group we thought was diverse. Could you tell me where you went to law school?
Stanford.
Harvard.
Yale.
Stanford.
Dartmouth.
What's your background?
Urban middle class.
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 What's your career ambition?
I'd like to make partner.
Make partner.
I'd like to make partner.
Partner.
Partner?
One last question. Who are you going to vote for in the next election?
Whoever's against tort reform.
Whoever's against tort reform.
Tort reform.
Whoever's against tort reform.
Now let's go back to the group which we thought was not diverse. Excuse me, I'm curious to know your backgrounds.
Cleveland suburbs.
Everywhere. I'm an army brat.
Nairobi, Kenya.
Kingston, Jamaica.
The streets.
What's your career ambition?
Business.
Political activism.
I want to open a restaurant.
I just want a job, man.
Survival.
How about your religious beliefs?
I'm a non-practicing Catholic.
Muslim.
I'm a Christian.
The Lion of Judah. Jah.
My old lady goes to church. Not me.
And how are you going to vote in the next election?
Whoever's more conservative.
Whoever's more liberal.
I'm not a citizen yet.
Whoever will save the children.
In a booth.
So which group would you say is more diverse?
You know, those who believe in race-based diversity believe that race reflects more than color. They believe that people of different races and ethnicities not only look different, that they actually think different.
Which, of course, is just another way of saying that people of the same racial or ethnic group think the same. All blacks think alike, all whites think alike, all Hispanics think alike, and so on.
If that were so, we might see a scene like this one.
It shows the existential dilemma of the modern psyche in reaction to postmodernism.
No. It shows man's inhumanity to man, and clearly admonishes the viewer to get in touch with the inner child.
No. It's a representation of the artist's unresolved conflict with his father.
I think. Thank you! And welcome to the company. 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 Thank you, and welcome to the company.
I'm actually quoting diversity trainers. Quote, blacks and Hispanics approach situations in a man-to-man or feeling-caring manner, whereas white males function primarily on a man-to-object style based on power, close quote. Hey, but what, for example, if one parent is Hispanic and the other is non-Hispanic white? I guess you deal with that person in a feeling-caring man-to-object style.
Thank you, and welcome to the company.
Ma'am, I'm actually one quarter Cherokee Indian. And one quarter African American.
African American.
And 1/8 Hispanic, and 1/8 Pacific Islander, and 1/16 Croatian, 1/16 Chinese.
1/16 Chinese.
And 1/32 Eskimo.
1/32 Eskimo?
Yes, ma'am. My great, great, great grandmother was an Aleut. I really take after her, though.
Thank you, and welcome to the company.
Before we go on, we need to draw a very clear distinction between race and ethnicity on the one hand, and culture on the other. When we say that your race and ethnicity aren't important in defining who you are, we're not saying that your culture isn't important in defining who you are. Culture is important.
But culture is culture, and race and ethnicity are race and ethnicity. They are not the same. For example, I have a lot more in common with a white in Copenhagen than I do a black in rural Nigeria. The Nigerian and I share race. We don't share culture. The same holds true for ethnicity. There are millions of Hispanics in the world, but they live in many different countries with very diverse cultures.
¿Me podría decir dónde queda el cuarto de conferencia y dónde se tienen las...?
I'm sorry, I'm Hispanic, but I don't speak much Spanish. Do you speak French?
¿Qué?
Parlez-vous français?
No comprendo.
Yes, but soccer. What is soccer?
You know, where you kick a ball around the field.
No, of course, of course. That's football.
No. Football is guys tackling and wrestling each other.
No. That's rugby, old chap. Rugby.
Oh, you crumpet head. I give up.
所以我完全听不懂你在说什么。所以也许根本没有关系。Celebrate
your culture. Teach it to your children. But don't make the mistake of confusing your culture with your race or ethnicity. They're not the same.
Even more than culture, what unites us is values. Mahatma Gandhi, a Hindu, was killed by a Hindu.
John F. Kennedy, a white American, was killed by a white American.
Yitzhak Rabin, an Israeli Jew, was killed by an Israeli Jew.
Anwar Sadat, an Egyptian Muslim, was killed by an Egyptian Muslim.
These great men were murdered by people who shared their cultures, but not their values. You know, one of the worst consequences of race-based thinking is that it pushes us toward people with whom we may share little and cuts us off from people with whom we may share a great deal.
You like carp?
Like it. I rub it.
I go carp fishing every weekend.
Me too. Ever seen this magazine before?
Ever seen it? I got every issue.
Me too. I'm a member of the National Carp Spearfishermen Association.
No, I'm a member of NASCA too.
We love carp.
Yes, we do.
We eat it all the time.
Carp! Oh, this is great.
You know, my friends say that carp spearfishing is stupid.
My friends think it's stupid too.
My name is Juan Ramirez.
Junichi Nishimura.
I see you on the shop floor.
Yeah, hard to get to know people around here.
Everybody likes hanging around the non-spearing carp fish groups.
Say, that table over there, you want to go grab it?
Vamos.
Sugoi.
Sure.
If you believe that ethnic and racial differences make people different from you, all you end up doing is depriving yourself of beautiful friendships.
If you share our views of diversity, that what matters is the individual and his or her character, you have to act on it.
Open yourself up to people of all races and ethnicities, precisely because those are not the things that matter.
Right this way, gentlemen. You know, we've worked very hard to create some diversity in our company. And here's an example, two of our very fine young Asian employees. Ladies. Right this way, gentlemen. It's a Latina female. Morning. And over here, I have one of our fine African-American employees. How you doing?
I'm from Canada, actually.
Yes, as a matter of fact, we have two Canadian African-Americans. We also have an African-American from England and one from France. We're very diversified. As a matter of fact, next month, we're going over to Africa and try to recruit some actual African-Americans in Africa.
Hey, wait a minute. I'm a hard-working man, and I'm tired of being reduced to just a color.
And if you hired me because of the color of my skin, then you put me in a situation that I can never win.
I don't wake up in the morning thinking that I'm black. When I look into the mirror, all I see is Jack. Jack with two cars, two kids, a wife and a cat. And if you hire me because I'm ethnic, then all I'll ever be is that.
Some call me a Chicana, some call me a Latina, but I am just a person named Rosa Montevina. I can succeed on my own, I'm not sitting on anyone's lap. And if you hired me because I'm ethnic, then all I'll ever be to you is that.
They don't usually do this.
Race-based thinking is nothing but a bunch of crap. And if you hired us because we're different,
then all I'll ever be,
all you'll ever see,
all you'll ever be.
Anyway, if you'll follow me, gentlemen.
Most people want to be known first by their individual character and abilities rather than by their race or ethnicity.
So rather than pursuing diversity on the basis of race or ethnicity, why not pursue it on the basis of character and ability?
The irony is you'll end up with diversity anyway because there are so many people of good character and ability in every group.
Strengthen your organization. Enrich your own life with a very diverse group from just one race, the race of decent human beings. I'm Larry Ober.
And I'm Dennis Prager. Thank you.
Who's that fluffy bundle of love? It's Princess, Princess. Special little muffin, just as sweet and easy is. Princess, Princess. Run and jump, Princess. Princess, duck and hide. Who's the one that tubby rubs? Cute as a baby is. Who loves adventure and plays all day? It's Princess, isn't it, yes? Let's see what she does today. Today's episode, Princess hears a strange noise.
What's the matter?
Let's make love.
No, I just want to make you feel good.
But I want to make love.
Well, I can't tonight.
Why?
Because I have a yeast infection.
Oh, you shouldn't have said that.
Oh, excuse me, Richard, it's the truth. Do you want me to do it faster?
A little slower. Can you talk dirty?
Talk dirty?
Yeah, you know, say nasty things.
Like what?
Well, like, you know, talk about my cock.
Your cock? Oh, honestly, Richard.
Here, just say this.
That's a hot fucking cock.
Say it again.
That's a hot fucking cock, fuck.
Oh, a little faster. Oh, yeah.
Can you hold on a minute? I have to take a dump.
Oh, I was so close!
What?
Dump? Did you have to say dump?
You said talk dirty.
Not like that!
Just hold on 1 second.
Maybe I'll just do this myself. Oh, yeah. That's it. Oh!
What?
Almost there.
Richard, my arm's gonna fall off.
Can't you use the other one?
I used the other one for 2 hours. It's numb.
Well, then can't you, you know...
What?
You know.
You know I don't like that, Richard.
But this is killing me! I've been about to have an orgasm for 3 hours. I'm about to explode!
All right.
No, yeah, that's good. Faster. Slower. Faster. Can I turn on a porno?
What?
Please? I can order it off the pay-per-view. I'm gonna die if I don't have release. Please!
Fine. I just don't want to see it.
Oh, yeah. That's right.
Oh, my God. That's disgusting.
Oh. Damn it. The porno's not even working.
Christopher Lowell Show.
Hi, everybody. Let's do some interior decorating.
Oh, yeah. Honey? Honey? Oh, my God. Oh, my God, Princess. What are we going to do?
Be sure to see our next episode, Princess Meets Officer Friendly. Who's that fluffy bundle of love? It's Princess! And today's episode, Princess Meets Officer Friendly.
So, what you're telling us, Mr. Richards, is that you took a half bottle of Viagra,
which gave you a 5-hour boner and eventually caused you to ejaculate so much that you blew your wife's head off.
I knew you wouldn't believe me.
Oh, no, I believe you. This is the 18th case like this we've seen.
What?
Yes. Ever since Viagra showed up, we've been having little problems like this.
Little problems? I have to go downstairs now and tell my son what happened. Oh, God. How am I going to tell him?
I understand there's been an accident. Where's the body?
Who are you?
Oh, well, I'm the body checker guy.
You mean the coroner?
Yes, I'm the coroner. Coroner, I need about 10 minutes alone with the body.
All right.
Make it 20.
Fine. Mr. Roberts, if we could just step out so the coroner could do his work.
I have to tell Tommy. Oh, God.
Yeah, that's a hot dead body. Oh, yeah.
Tommy, Daddy has to tell you something.
All right, Dad.
Tommy, when a man and a woman fall in love, they are attracted to each other, and they want to be close to each other. And sometimes the man takes his penis and puts it into something the woman has called a vagina. But sometimes, instead of putting his penis in her vagina, he puts it in her mouth. And if he's been taking too much Viagra without any release, he can blow the woman's head clean off. And that's what I did to your mother. Do you understand?
No.
Shh! Shut up, dog! Quiet! You're ruining the moment! Quiet, dog!
Wait, just a minute, Joe. I think she's trying to tell us something. What is it, girl? The barn's on fire? Old Mr. Mulligan is stuck in the well. A small deaf child is all alone on Haskins Bridge.
Maybe she's just in heat.
Oh, yeah. That's right.
And so you see, Tommy, Mommy's in heaven now, looking down on both of us.
How is she looking at us if you blew her head off?
Not now, Princess.
I think she wants us to follow her upstairs to Mommy.
Tommy! No!
Don't miss next week's episode, Princess Finds a Red Balloon.